You're on. Deke, you're on. Deacon Greg, we're ready. Deacon Greg, we're ready.
Good evening. Welcome to our
good evening.
Bible study class. Located at 3500 4th Street. We invite many to come and share with us. But if not, you can catch us online like you're catching us now.
Amen.
We love to have you. We love to learn about the Lord and what He has for us to do. And in the book of Romans, which we're studying, is a good place to be.
Yes, sir.
I mean, the whole book is good, but this is a good place to be. As it talks about as it talks about Paul's journey, as he started his ministry through the latter chapters of the New Testament. So that's where we're going to start. We'll have a word of prayer. Eternal God, Father, we thank you for this moment, Lord.
Yes, Lord, yes.
We thank you for bringing us together, Lord. We thank you for encouraging us to study your word, Father.
Yes, Lord, yes.
Because it's our word of life, Lord. It is our word of encouragement for you,
yes,
Lord,
yes.
That if we follow what you have for us to do, that we won't have any problems to worry about, Lord. Because we know you're always with us, you never forsake us, and you will never leave us, Father.
Thank you, Lord. Thank
you. So we're here, Lord, to partake in your word and study in your chapter, Lord. We thank you, Lord, as we go forward. We bless the ones that have will and mind that want to be here, Father God. And we bless the ones that need to be here, but that aren't here, Father God.
Yes,
we just
Lord.
Continue that you anoint our heads with your wisdom, Father God, and we'll go on in, Father God. Now, as we partake in your chapter, Lord, we just ask that you guide us as you do, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, we'll start with chapter 16 in Romans. Everybody will... and help her in whatever she may need from you, for she has been. Oh, I went past. Huh? No, I didn't.
Yeah, yeah, be well, Pastor.
Yeah.
Well, like I said, these letters are small, so it's hard for me to see.
You mind making your own chapter?
Okay. read the second one again. I'm sorry.
You want my book?
That ye receive her in the Lord as becoming saints. And
we, my dear friend, whoever, who was the first convert to Christ in the province of Asia.
Greet Mary, who has worked hard for you.
Salute.
Mm-hmm.
Andronicus. And Junina, my kinsman, my fellow prisoner, who are the note among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me.
Greet Amplius, my beloved in the Lord.
Greet your Urbanus, our co-worker in Christ, and my dear friend,
Statues.
Okay. Greet
Apollos,
tested and approved. In Christ.
Uh-huh.
Greet those who belong to the households of
Aristobulus.
Amen.
Aristobulus. Okay. Greet my kinsman, Herodian. Greet those in the Lord who belong to the family of Narcissus.
Okay, mine's dead.
Well,
are in the Lord.
Who are you?
Come in King James Version.
Yeah.
So
I got the King James.
Yeah, it says a little more.
It's a little different. It's a little more on the end.
Wait a minute. Did I read 10?
No, you're right. NIV, you're fine. We just had a little more on King James.
Yeah, salute.
Chafina.
Chafina. And
Chifosa.
And Chifosa. Who labor in the Lord. Salute the beloved Persia, which labor much in the Lord.
Salute Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother and mine.
Can mean either servant in 13:4, 15:8, and 1 Corinthians 3:5, Timothy 4:8, or deacon. Referring to a church office. Okay, I think there's another word for it, but Sendai was a port town just 6.5 miles, 10.5 kilometers east of Corinth. All right. So that is what that word means. The word diakonos and deacon, in their way, that's what that word means, and what it means is to be a servant.
Amen.
Any questions? Yeah. Any questions on one?
So he was reading the commentary for verse 1.
Okay, I think I read a couple again, but 1 and 2.
Yes.
And 3.
Everybody in the commentary is different.
I read 1, 2, and 3 together.
That was 1, 2, and 3?
No, 1 and 2. 3 starts the next one.
Right. Word.
So 1 and 2 I read together.
Okay.
And it means servant, mm-hmm. and how we should meet and greet one another.
Man 3, the word deacon refers, here to a Christian designated to serve with the overseer, elder of the church, in a variety of ways. Similarly, sanctity in Philippians 1:1 and Timothy 2:3-12. Chapter 3:8-12.
Anybody else
say anything? Yeah, my commentary is a little different than New James. It says a servant. This is one passage used in support of the office of deaconess. No specific
specific.
It just got stuck. However, are given of such an office, such as women, are better viewed as being either the wife of a deacon or a godly widow who were supported financially by the church. Here is the best understanding of the role to be that of a helper. So, yeah, like you said, we're all servants. It's just by the deaconess. Mm-hmm. Their roles. Okay, move on.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
Said that she was a woman of God and a servant, and she was a wealthy woman.
All right.
A deaconess. And she was one that helped support the get the letters from Corinth to Rome to Paul. So she was the first woman that was played an important role in the early church. But she set a great example as a servant of God to help Paul while he was in prison in his ministry.
Well, I put a little more emphasis on as far as helping Paul while he was in jail. Okay. Anybody else?
Is that the one or two? That was one or two.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'm 16.
fellow workers in Christ Jesus. And I'll read four as well. Who risked their necks for my life, to whom not only I gave thanks, but all the churches of the Gentiles gave thanks as well. Mm-hmm. That's saying a mouthful.
Unlike what we would do,
you know.
Our people died with a Christian fellowship.
Well, I think once the Lord has accepted the Gentiles and stuff, I think that was a great move. Mm-hmm. Because see, it not only brought back the Jewish people to God, but I think it kind of made the Jewish people kind of jealous. Like, okay, God's given up on us, and so these people will find somebody else to worship. So then I think they climbed back on board, and things became a little different between Jews and Gentiles.
Okay. Well, that's because...
And 16 and 2, and here said, Paul calls upon the church to assist Phoebe, since she has helped so many. Phoebe served as a patron. Probably with financial assistance and hospitality. Well, that brings me to think, our hospitality group. Uh-huh. You know, they always cook up something for us to have when we're having our gatherings and meetings and things like that. So that's a good thing to have in the church is its patrons that do hospitality things.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Well, this was a beautiful picture of Priscilla and Aquila because mm-hmm. they were a married couple.
Mm-hmm.
And it's nothing like a married couple that knows the Lord.
All right.
They can be a servant of God.
Mm.
Yep. You know, that mama's not going in one direction and dad going another, that they are working together for the cause of Christ.
Amen.
And that's what Priscilla and them showed Paul, that we can be a service in our hospitality here, what we do as a team.
Mm-hmm.
And they became very close friends
mm-hmm.
to Paul.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But there was nothing like a husband and a wife. Both Christians,
yes.
Both believers,
yes.
Both servants of the Lord.
Amen.
Because that's the most difficult thing that you can see is a married couple and the wife comes into Christ, but the husband continues doing what he wants to do. That caused division.
Or vice versa.
Yeah, between the marriage.
Yes.
Yeah, so, like you said, that's the best thing in the world is to have a husband and wife both worshiping and working for Christ.
But think how many people they set the example for.
Wow.
Yeah, but see,
you know.
But see, the thing here, the Jewish people had not abided God's word. So that's why he accepted us as Gentiles. And he gave it to us, and then that's when the Jewish people got upset. Because...
Well, it takes me back to thinking not only at New Hope, but even at Pilgrim Rescue, we have great men and women teams. Deacons,
yeah,
stuff like that, you know, just great men and women teams. And I can remember vividly Brother Washington. He said,
yeah,
he after Sunday school, he said, well, I'll be right back. I gotta go pick up the wife. He go pick up the wife and he come back with a whistle. You know, great men around him. I mean, I learned so much from all of them, actually. But, you know, and then Brother Holmes.
Oh, yeah.
You talk about a unique way of playing.
Uh-huh.
Oh, he had it. He had it. But, I ran across many of great men and women teams in the church. And I have to brag on my pastor because he makes me jealous. But they lead by example.
Yeah.
They lead by example. They don't try to push nothing over, do anything. If he needs to tell you something, you pull you aside and say, hey, great man.
And teach them how to conflict.
Yes.
Down.
Yes.
When the husband and wife are children of God and they're working together as a team, it keeps a lot of conflict down. He said, they said, what said?
See, now
it keeps a lot of that
down.
Hoopla, I call it.
Well, yeah, because 9 times out of 10, when you find a combination that way, you got backbiters that sitting there trying to create confusion between the married couple. But it's the strength between the two that backbiting and talking bad about one or the other, it just rolls off of them.
All right, we'll move on. next for my life, to whom not only I gave thanks, but all the churches of the Gentiles gave thanks as well. Okay, well, being grateful, you know, for somebody to save your life, I mean, you being overly abundant in thanks.
Yes, yes.
Saying that, you know, thank you
for saving me.
Thank you for saving me, you know, in a time of need.
Uh-huh.
And so, things like that happen, it takes me back to our Savior.
Yeah.
And as he died on the cross, all we can do is give thanks for giving us another way back to God.
Yes.
And that saved us. So, in essence, he saved our lives.
Yeah.
And I know it's a little tough because, like I said, you know, Jesus is one thing. And, you have to look at it as, you know, could you or would you put your life in the line of fire for somebody else? And it's a tough thing. But I will say that if you're doing it in the way of righteousness, God bless you.
Amen.
God bless you. Any questions on that?
You know what I like about this? Paul greeted them. Mm-hmm. But he told them what standing they are with the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? This is not just a general person that don't know the Lord. This was a man that was converted and found Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
And now he's a servant of the Lord. So I like the way he greeted them and let them know where their standing was in the Lord.
Matter of fact, he allowed them to be friends with him while he was in the
Yes.
Because he told them their standings in the church.
Right.
So he allowed them to be friends and to minister unto others.
Right.
Deacon Gregory, you were talking about that verse 4. Those who have laid down their lives and how it brought to your remembrance what Jesus did for us. I think it's interesting also to point out that Jesus, you know, when people would be more grateful, like you say, if somebody died for them. But when we think about Jesus, I think our thinking is a little skewed. We think that only spiritually, he died for us. And the spiritual part of that, we can't really see it, so he don't value it as much.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus not only died so that we could have life spiritually, but he gave his physical life up to
Yes.
If we're waiting for somebody to die for us, like you said, Jesus already did.
Yes, he did.
He gave his physical life so that we could have not only spiritual life, but he says, I bless you here as well.
Right.
When our focus is right, God says, if you focus on heaven, I'm going to bless you down here on earth as well.
Right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Praise God. All right. Anybody else? Moving on. Let me see. I think we're at number 5 now. Right? I just saw that. That's 6, 4, 5. Greek. Greet also the church in their house. Greet my beloved Epaphroditus, who was the first convert to Christ in Asia. Mm. Well, that, it takes me back a couple of places. Take me back to Moses.
All right.
You know, coming off the fiery mountain and going back to Egypt to free God's people. Another place it takes me to is the chosen 12. You know, they kind of went through a small period of disbelief, but after a few things happened, their faith strengthened, mm-hmm. and they knew the Messiah. And even though one betrayed him, the others stuck with him. Now there was a few that had a few doubts, like Peter. But then Peter came to know, as we all have come to know, that Christ is our Savior.
Yes, yes.
Any questions? Any other questions? Let me see, that was five. It says, in the church, in their house, apparently a house, church met in the house of Priscilla and Chloe. He refers to a province in what is in modern day Turkey. Any questions? We move on to six. Greet Mary, who has worked hard for you. I'll read seven as well. Greet Ananias and Juanita and Junior, I'm sorry. Meet Ananias and Junior, my kinsmen, and my fellow prisoners. They are well known to the apostles, and they were in Christ before me. Well, you look around, and you run into people that were in Christ Jesus before we were. Mm-hmm. So it looks to our elders, just like, mother took us to church, things like that. Mm-hmm. But what we're, you know, as being on the baby milk of the Bible, what we really understand? No.
Not that
no. But see, like mother, I'm sure she was understanding, because she had been there. She's still there.
Amen.
But we have come up now to where we understand. We're trying to get off the goat's milk and everything else, and we're trying to grow as proper Christians as we should do. Any other questions?
As you mentioned, man, even though when we were young, when I was young, my mom and dad made me go to church.
Don't feel by yourself.
I'm glad they did, because even though I didn't understand what was going on, something was being worked in me, even though I didn't know what was going on. And I thank God that they kept me in the church, and then pretty soon they didn't have to make me go. I wanted to go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely.
So I thank God for my parents and I know
that was that old bad spirit trying to hold us back. Why you going to go to church, man? You know that one.
Not on that.
Don't like you.
not on that. But even for the young that didn't go, somebody prayed for them. Because then, when it came to it, do I want to be bad or do I want to do good? Whatever they prayed for, you make that decision. So it's like somewhere in between being young to a teenager, somewhere in there, the word got to you that you want to come to church for some. But like I said, God knew what he had in store for me even before my mom gave birth to me.
Mm-hmm.
So regardless of whatever it was, he knew just my path.
Yeah.
So which way I'm going to go.
Well.
Yeah. And that just goes to show you that plan that he has for us.
Yeah.
But what I want to say is that I'm to know all of that. I didn't know this. You know, so I'm glad that they planted that seed.
Mm-hmm.
And then one day I came to mm-hmm. the water.
Amen.
To where now I'm getting water and I'm growing.
Amen.
You know,
absolutely.
Because sometimes it takes a lifetime for a person to just get that speck of water.
You learn it out.
Where
did
you come up?
Kind of sounds like that old familiar story of old Johnny Appleseed. You know, he threw the whole the apples in there, and next thing you knew, we had apple trees.
Mm-hmm.
And another thing is that, unlike Tony and myself, I don't know about anybody else, but, you know, you go back to the old proverb saying, train up a child.
That's
it,
sure. That's it.
When he gets old, he will not depart from it. So I think that was a part of me that got me going to church. You know, like you said, after, you know, mom and dad made me go to church, but after a while, I wanted to go to church.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's the good thing about the, those mothers and even fathers being, you know, they led the way so you would know where to go when that time came, because, you know, they know one day you was going to need it.
Mm-hmm.
You was going to need it, and that's the same thing we do with our children. We know one day you're going to need it. You may not feel like you need it now, but I'm going to still keep on watering you until, you know. So.
And I don't know how many of y'all, because I had my grandmother living at the time, too. I don't know how many of y'all been in the old book that was on Omni.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I went to church one Sunday, and you know, they had that wall there, so after a while they raised it. And I was sitting up in the balcony there, had my feet sitting on the ledge, had my feet dangling down. And it was just so vivid in my mind. And I'm thinking my grandmother going to the bathroom or something. I watched her get up out the sanctuary and all the way. Walked all the way under the thing, and I'm thinking she's gonna perish. She came up the stairs, grabbed me by my ear.
Oh, goodness.
Oh, my God, it hurt. Took me all the way back to the sanctuary and said, sit down. Uh-huh. Okay. But man, I sat and vividly watched it.
Uh-huh.
Watched her get up and move on. Didn't know tell her she was coming for me.
But that's
you know not listen for me, huh?
That's the thing about the church on road. The mothers would come and slap you upside the head when you were talking and chattering, and they'll come.
Yeah.
And they didn't even have to move. They could just look at
you.
Some of them,
you knew them straight up.
Yeah, if you're close enough, they look at you.
Now they look at you.
Now they won't run off.
And they did not turn around too many times.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, I think I was raised in a Christian home. And my daddy used to take us down to the church every Saturday and help clean the church.
Mm-hmm.
We couldn't go up in the pulpit area.
Mm-mm.
You know.
Mm-mm.
But we had our little dusting rags and cleaning rags, and then he'll give us a knife to peel all the gum off the wooden pews.
Mm-hmm.
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 Yeah.
Wow.
But he worked right with us, you know. And then he was a teacher in the Sunday school. Then when I got older, I became the superintendent of the Sunday school.
Mm-hmm.
And then I loved to teach.
Amen.
Back in them days, they had 1 hour after school, you could go down and get biblical teaching.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And this lady, Mrs. Big Dog, I never will forget her name. She brought flannelgraph to the church and taught biblical lessons.
Wow.
So I would go and learn from her, and then I would go down to the Bible bookstore and learn. So I got wrapped up in visual aid, child evangelism, and went out there to the Baptist church and had Bible study out there. And so, you know, then I went to nursing school and a Baptist minister had the youth, and we had to demonstrate a scripture and go to these white churches, but we never knew that these judges were ministers. And we had to present a scripture like, "Let your light so shine that men may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." Mm-hmm. We had to present that scripture. And then you got awarded for your youth group, you know, at your church.
And see, that was one of the things, like Pastor reiterated a couple weeks ago. You know, thinking of that old time of living, you can remember your mother and papa used to tell you, we used to go to church from sun up to sun down.
Sun down, that's right.
And in that verse 5, it says that the church that is in their house.
In their house.
So they didn't have church buildings like we have
today. No.
So they had to meet in their house. And that's where church started.
Right.
Church for us today needs to start in people's houses.
Amen.
Where parents are raising up their children
in
the door and not waiting to send them to church or waiting to send them to school to get correction, but they need to be correcting them in the house.
Mm-hmm.
Bring them up in the house.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Amen.
Well, I have to tell you this. I'm a twin. And there's 14 sets of twins. There's twins on my mother's side and my father's side. And my mother had this little job in the evening, and Daddy calls himself babysitting. His babysitting was to keep us little twins out of trouble, was to take us in, and he would kneel down and pray with each one of us every side. That was his babysitting.
That was babysitting.
He knew who we were, and we knew we wasn't in trouble.
All right.
Right?
And you got to hear about God.
Yes. And so what we do, we mock Dad.
Okay. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, that's crazy.
As twins, when we went to bed, she had her bed here, but we would get our one bed together. Mm-hmm. And we pray and mock Dad.
Train.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And mock their dad.
That's good.
But I never forget the deacons used to say, you know, "Lord, thanks for waking me up. I didn't be on my cooling board." I could never figure out what they were talking about.
That cooling board.
That cooling board.
That cooling board.
You know, their dad bathing. But they would say, "The Lord, that you kept me, that I didn't be on my cooling board."
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to read 8 and 9 together because they're short. It says, "Greet Amphilitus and my beloved in the Lord, and greet Urbanus, our fellow worker in Christ, and may the love Stichus God's house in which we do, we greet people. Number 10 says, greet Apelles, who is approved in Christ. Greet those who belong to his family of Aristobulus.
Stephanus.
Huh?
Aristobulus.
Aristobulus, okay. Greet my kinsman, Rhodian. Greet those in the Lord who belong to the family of Narcissus. Greet those workers in the Lord, Tryphenaeum and Tryphosma. Greet the beloved Persis, who has worked hard in the Lord. Greet Rufus, who was my grandfather's name.
Rufus.
Chosen in the Lord. Also his mother, who has been a mother to me as well. All right, we'll stop right there. Because in verse 13, that is something. And you know, us growing up in the neighborhood, that there ought to stick with us in saying who is my mother as well. Because in the neighborhood, you couldn't run around the block and get in trouble. Because that woman gonna whoop you, and yours gonna whoop you when you get home.
I like your mother, Jeff. When I turn that porch light on, you better be coming through that gate or coming up to the cell.
If you set the lights, you see the light on.
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
I
know. I still got a little time.
Yeah, so that there set well with me because it happened to me a couple times. Yeah, you kind of had to get a donut to sit on, you know.
So, I'm just thinking back, how back in the day, mothers, especially mothers, they would take in the whole neighborhood.
Absolutely. That's why they say it took a village.
And I think that's why today, First Lady and I, we just, if a kid come over, we just take them in.
Yes.
We just feed everybody. I think I have more adopted kids than I know what to do with.
Right.
But I'm glad they come over because I guess they feel it's a safe environment and they trust us.
Yeah.
And we minister to them, so.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that's why I stopped there because, like I said, you know, it's been my mother as well. But that said well with me in the neighborhood because you couldn't go three blocks, four blocks around and think you was going to get away with something.
Nah. But boy, you
was not going to happen.
Nah.
And you talk about you knowing a lot of people. I talk about my parents. I say, come you know everybody. Just ain't nobody around there. You can say, oh yeah, I know Mr. So-and-so. We live around here on the ain't nothing I can say.
One funny thing that happened to me was we were like 14 years old. It was like five or six of us. We walked from East 31st all the way out by the county jail. Wow. There were some horses out there. That horse kicked me so hard, I did three somersaults back. See, that was the Lord blessing me because if that horse wouldn't have went up any further because he got me in the car. If he wouldn't have went up any further, I wouldn't have been here sitting with you today. But I get home, I'm walking pig leg because that's where they kicked me on both sides. And I tried to go down the steps and my mama hollered, no, you don't. You take your butt in there and take a shower. That's what you get from running around and knowing you don't need to be out there.
Well, you're right about that.
I had one of the kids' friend. He sent me a text, and I looked at it, and I was like, oh, let me read it. Well, it was a message. He verbally sent it, and he said, you know, Miss Pearl, what did I call Miss P? He said, one thing
Absolutely.
We couldn't come in here.
Not with no food. With
that. And I was just like, oh, he said, you can say, I know you don't, because at that time I didn't know who it was. He said, I know you don't know who this is. He said, but I just wanted you to know that I respected you then, I respect you now. And I thank you because you didn't put up with no stuff. You didn't have no stuff coming up there. He said, there was a lot of mothers that we could go to their house and just act a fool and do whatever. He said, but I'm so glad that I felt at peace at your house. And something he said, I caught that voice. And it was Jesse, one of the kids, that his mother was a very true woman of God as well. I wasn't like into my the minister of God like I am now. And I caught his name, and then I'm sorry, this sounded like Jesse. And so I called him and I left on his message. I said, I couldn't catch your voice at first, but I believe it's the Jesse. He called me right back. He said, see, I knew you would catch my voice. And it was such an amazing thing because, you know you do right. You know you want to do good. You try to be good to people and you see all that. But until they can tell you that this is how I feel and this is what I see, you know, it gives you a little more to me, it was a little more to that push to God. Because I, like I said, I was in my early 50s when I came and gave my life. You know, I always, like I said, I was raised with knowing God. My mom kept it in me. My grandmother kept it in me. I knew God, but I know God.
Amen.
You know, so, amen. Yeah, it was really good to hear that.
All right.
Okay, young woman.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to read 14, 15, and 16. It says, "Greet Asunquidus of Philodon, Hermas, Patrobus, Hermas, and the brothers who are with him. Greet Philologus, Julian, Nercus, and his sister, and Olympia, and all the saints who were with them. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ greet you." All right. So saying that, you know, it's just like going to do another service at another church, you know. The other church, the saints, should greet you with a holy kiss and stuff like that. In certain places it still is, but in certain places you're right, they've got a little stuffy, you know.
Well, no, that's because of the virus.
Besides that. Yeah, that's the way it's
supposed. You better tap the elbow is.
So now I'm reading this bumping elbows and all that sort of stuff. So, yeah.
But you know, I look at this, what's going on right now, and I look at how it closed churches at one time, separated us at one time. I look at, you know, Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy.
Mm-hmm.
And he wants us to be divided like this. But look at what God said. Look at what he said that God wanted. He said he wants us to greet and love on and kiss on and greet one another with love. So now we in the fact that we're looking at what we used to could do. And now here we are in a situation that, you know, you might come hug pastor, but then you might elbow the next person you see. Because, I mean, you know, you don't know where they been and what they, you know, every time somebody goes to a gathering, three or four people come back saying that somebody was there with something, and now they got to be shut down. And so I say that to just say it's so sad that we have to look back on what we could have it used to do. When we stopped doing a lot of this here before the pandemic.
Yeah, but just put white shit on me. But you got to realize that this what we're going through right now was prophesied way back then.
Yeah.
That we would have famine and we would have. Well,
I'm gonna read this one thing in the Bible. Do you have anything to add, Pastor?
It'll come back to me.
Okay. On this it says, on this thing of false teaching, Christians must be alert for these false believers and advise people to advise people. People are attracted to his speech, but are motivated by selfish desires. So yeah, that's saying what we gotta be aware of is the false teachings. And as we all say all the time, you got to read and know your Bible for itself. Show us, study to show thyself approved.
But, you know, okay, this again with this pandemic that's separating us. You know, I have talked to some people and they're like, this is man-made, they just want to close the church together, this is safe, we just want to work this in there. Okay, we done had the chicken flu, we done had the AIDS, we done had all of that that started then separating us right there. So then it comes, this is here that's all over the whole world.
Yeah.
So
because they can come with this here that's sitting on the broke out in Africa or it broke out over here. And then we stop coming together. They had to come with something stronger. And now here it is that then this worldwide, and all the people that have passed on with this. I mean, for you to just know a number that's supposed to be, it just overwhelms me because, again, you're trying to shut churches down that where you can go and be saved.
Mm-hmm.
No matter if you get it, if I got it, I still know that, hey, I'm in the hands of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
You know? But people that you're separating, they're not looking at it like I'm in the hand of the Lord. They're looking at it, why God doing this to me, you know?
Well, then you can say that. Why is he coming to bring this here?
Well,
say this. I believe that this virus is a warning for God.
Right.
For in 2 Chronicles 14, 7 verse, if my people that were called by my name, and you know what? If the church and the word is within us, what an opportunity we have, really, to witness, to be a witness. You know, because the church is with us.
Yes.
Isn't our bodies a temple of God?
Yeah.
So, to me, we have no excuse not to be a witness, not to introduce them to God's word, not to let the world know who God is. We need a revival to break out.
Yeah.
Because it's really not telling how many people are saved. They're just telling me about the ones that died.
Right. You know, I mean, I was up to 226,000.
But look at us tonight. Look at us tonight. We're not even in that number.
No.
Thank you, Jesus. And
hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is keeping us
from getting that.
For doing, to do his work. There needs a revival right now.
Yes, yes.
Not just in Colorado, but the whole world. Because this had touched the whole world. And this is my Father's work.
Come on.
My Father's work. And I believe he's keeping us Christians. He's keeping us believers. He's keeping us to do his work. Because he on his way back.
Yes, ma'am.
You can see the signs. Huh? You really don't have no playtime. Oh, you really can't make no excuses.
Stand up.
Yeah. We really don't have no excuses
tonight
to be a witness.
That's right.
To God's word.
Huh?
To God's word. We can't.
That's the way I feel about it.
Well, no, you're right, because like I said, it was mentioned in old times. That we would have famines, and we would have deaths, and viruses, anything that, even right now, people don't even have enough money to get food. They depended on somebody to be able to get food from somebody, but they don't realize we're getting close to work. We're in the
and realize that God is their provider.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, we fail to know the power of God.
Yeah.
He is our provider.
That's good.
Yeah.
Yes, he is.
Huh?
Yep.
And he does everything. You know, he had a hurricane. We had tornadoes. We had the fires. All these warnings.
Yeah.
But not until he touched us personally with his virus.
Yep.
Now that's the way I that's the way I look at it. And that was the whole world is affected.
Everybody's affected.
All right.
Everybody.
All right.
You know, I mean, we have climate change where the last Antarctic is melting at a rate, which is causing all the different effects in the world. Yeah.
Right.
I mean, not only hurricanes, but what is it, some tsunamis in all them Asian countries where the waves wipe them out. Mm-hmm. And the Bahamas and the other central little countries like St. John and St. Thomas, like Puerto Rico, been hit so many times, you might as well just forget about trying to visit them because they don't have nothing. But I'm going to stop. So I'm going to finish.
Go ahead. I'm just going to say this one thing because I'm so glad that you gave me a different look at this. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad this is the reason why we come together like this so we can understand. Because even the death of my son, it touched me. Mm-hmm.
can't go nowhere.
And oh my son, my family, but this pandemic, and if they get born, and they start to go back, they have to do anything. So I see what you're saying, that this touched everybody. This opened eyes to a lot of different things. Then when we lose a loved one, or when we lose our house, or when we lose those things, because they soon just, they're in the past. But this is right here in our place.
Continue.
And it's going to bring us a lot of people to God.
Mm-hmm.
And it's
like
a lot of people still not getting it.
Yeah.
But just like your son, he may not knew the time came for it, but he made preparation.
Yes, he did.
Before he passed away. So if anything, you can cry of joy, because you know you want to see your son one day soon.
Well, that's not kind of what I was saying. I'm just saying that how when it touched us, because you know, he was close to us,
right.
And death touches families, but then what do we do? We remember.
You know, a lot of times when things are the status quo, we take them for granted.
Right.
But now that churches have been closed, they were closed for a few months.
Yes.
And people were just frantic. They, oh, I gotta go to church. I can't wait till the church. Then the doors of the church open. And then they come back for a few weeks and then go right back to the status quo.
Yeah, yeah, before this, there was a falling away from the church.
Yes, yes.
Instead of them coming, they're falling away.
We need to understand there could come a time when they close the churches down permanently and you can't get in. What you going to do then?
You ask.
If we don't have that personal relationship with God, like what he's talking about, we are in trouble.
We are in trouble.
Well, what we want to do is go up in the mountain and find all the abandoned mine and be in there.
People, we should take advantage of the church while the church is open.
Amen.
The church, there should never be a service where there's not standing anymore.
And you know, you say that, and I ask people from before, I said, was the church open? They said, no, they're not open yet. And I'm like, well.
He gave us the man technology.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that they could take that technology and Zoom or whoever that is. Facebook. There's still ways that you connect with the believer.
That's what we're doing right there.
What?
All they have to do is put on and get on. That's what we do right there.
Right.
But right then, they have that ministry every Sunday morning. When you come to all these tales, Joe.
Pastor,
the one
that
comes on.
Curly hair.
Yeah. Look at that. I mean, but that's probably before the virus hit, that he has so many people in his congregation.
Uh-huh.
You know, because for one, he has so much money that he can have church on Sunday, like we are here. But then turn right back around, we can't get 20 people up in here.
We almost built a house, sir.
Well, I know.
Changes in Alexander's been together.
But like I told First Lady, many people. Well, we're going to have to follow it. Yeah. What Colorado has mandated for us, which is we need to be 6 feet apart from each other, like that physical distance. So even though we had so they were not, you know,
right.
Yes,
for each other.
Yeah.
But I understand what Bob was saying. Yeah. A lot of people are substituting Facebook and Zoom and all this technology instead of coming together. Oh, I can just get it online. I can just, you know, watch it on YouTube.
Yeah.
But the Bible says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Now, I know we have to follow laws, too. And we have to follow the government's laws, except for when they contradict God's word. So there's a fine line there. But we should never love getting online church more than we do being together.
Right. It's, like you said, it's good to come to people that are in agreement with you.
Yeah.
Okay. Going on to number 17.
All right.
The time is getting says, I appeal to you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions and create obstacles contrary to the doctrine that you have been taught. Avoid them.
Mm-hmm.
Well, like I said, that was what I just read about avoiding false doctrine and things like that. 18 says, for such persons do not serve our Lord Christ, but their own appetites. And by smooth talk and flattery, they deceive the hearts of the naive.
Ooh.
So in other words, they're just saying, don't be fooled. You know, and look out for those type of things. For your obedience is known to all, so that I rejoice over you, but I want you to be wise as to what is good and innocent as to what is evil. So that verse there is saying that we need to know good from evil.
Yeah.
You know, we need to do the good of God and forsake the evil of the devil.
That's why it's so good to know the word.
Yeah, I know.
The only word, God's word is the only one that's given us a lifeline.
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Mm-hmm.
That's really given us a lifeline.
Yeah.
His word.
Mm-hmm. So it goes on to say, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under his feet.
Yeah.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And on that note, in my book, it says, with an allusion to Genesis 3:15, the readers are assured of Satan will soon be destroyed.
Yes.
Mm. Yes.
Isn't that time coming soon?
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Mm. All right, we'll read on. Timothy, my fellow workers, greet you, as do Lucius and Jason and Sosifer, my kinsman. I, Tertius, who wrote this letter, greet you in the Lord. Gaius, who is the host to me and the whole church, greets you. Aretas, the city treasurer, and our brother Quartus greet you. Which brings us, somebody got 24, you want to read that?
Lord, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen.
And 25 says, now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but has now been disclosed and through the prophetic writings has been made known to all the nations according to the command of the eternal God to bring about the obedience of faith. Once again, there we are at that word again. Faith. Having faith.
All right.
Having faith in the Lord will have him guide you through. And like I say, everything's not done through words, but faith.
Faith.
That's what the main commandment.
He says, do the good works, which we do the good works, but the belief is where it lies.
Amen.
To the only God, wise, be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
All right, well, I hope we got something out of that. Anybody have any questions about the rest of that?
You did a great job.
Good job.
And as I said, Mother has a thing there of this is what we do in our Bible study class. These are the books we use. This one's the bare bones. Here's another one through the Bible in here. And here's another one, what the Bible is all about. These are books we use at Greater Shield on Tuesday mornings as she covers the lessons that we go through.
Amen.
Y'all can look at those.
The back of the lesson of Romans. Mm-hmm. What this book of Romans was telling you.
And these books are divided. So they're separated into the chapters.
Okay.
I mean into the books. So as we go through, we use these to cover portions of what we just read.
Amen.
Do you want me to read it?
Yeah.
All of it?
Yeah, this right here.
It says, life lessons from Rome. Everything you receive as a Christian, your salvation, your justification, your satisfaction,
sanctification,
and someday your glorification. Is a work of God's grace. Inward change will produce a corresponding outward fruit. Whatever is true about your heart will show up in your action. The righteousness of God is a gift that comes, that can be received only by faith, not earned by your works. Faithfulness in the little things will prepare you for greater tasks from God.
Amen.
So there is that word again. Faith approaches us one more time.
Amen.
And like I said, once we get back to where we can get the class, maybe sometime you'll love to join us. We have it at 9:30. 9 o'clock and 9:30.
9 o'clock.
Pardon?
9 o'clock and 9:30. 9:30. On Tuesdays. Yeah, because down the
recreation.
Yes, well,
the recreation center.
Well, we have a lot of seniors, and it's probably about keeping us out of here.
Oh, that's very much wrong.
That's the song you want.
But we have a great time.
Well, if you know offhand what you're going to say, I need to bring it up on YouTube and try to go through. So I'll be up there the next thing.
I can see the website.
I know, and that's why I actually need help.
I need to
a sheet of the songs we're going to sing. So we have words.
Okay.
Pastor,
yes, ma'am.
Now, this is what we do before we start our Bible lesson.
And I gave everybody a copy.
men.
Oh, you got a copy?
Yes. Yeah, I gave him a copy of that.
This will be, let's close out with prayer. I'll read you this as we are closing prayer.
Okay.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome in my life.
Yes.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome in my life. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in my life. Transform every condition, situation, and circumstance of my life, making my life a living reflection of the goodness and glory of God. Holy Spirit, transform me, transform me, transform me. Transform every part of me that is not in keeping with God's love, God's goodness, God's purpose, and God's perfect plan for me to live a life of joy, peace, wholeness, ease, harmony, and abundance. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in my mind. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in my heart. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in my life. Help me to be all that God created me to be. For your presence, I am so grateful. Let it be so, and so it is. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Well, it starts on the other side, actually. But
yeah. Well, you can do it if you want.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can if you want.
No.
I give you enough.
I've been sick